Welcome to the Robert Christian Show. I'm your host, Robert Christian. What an interesting day that it is, and it has already been proven to be an interesting day. But I want to make your day a little bit better and your week considerably better, and hopefully by the end of this show, we can do just that. My goal, my aim is to inspire, it is to uplift, it is to give power back to the American people in one way or another, and for everybody to feel that, you know what, you have the power to help to change things, to create things, to be open-minded and to say, you know what, where do we go from here? But before we can ask the question, where can we go from here? We should ask ourselves the question, how did we get here to begin with? A very interesting side note as I begin today's live show. Back on July the 21st, there was a poll that was taken that suggested that Donald Trump had a 33% chance of being impeached. And this was back in July. And now we find this.
The Robert Christian Show, addressing issues that matter.
Let's start looking at a solution. It may be shocking to you.
And now, your host, Robert Christian.
And thank you, Mr. Maestro, once again. Okay, folks, once again, I will open up with this. That July the 21st this year, a poll suggested that Donald Trump had a 33% chance of being impeached from office. And now we find that there is a 45% chance of Donald Trump being either impeached or him resigning. Special Counsel Robert Mueller's Russia investigation has gathered enough steam that some lawyers representing key Donald Trump associates are now considering the possibility of a historic first, an indictment against a sitting, in quotation, president. While many legal experts contend that Mueller lacks the standing to bring criminal charges against Donald Trump, at least two attorneys working with clients swept up the Russia probe, told Politico that they consider it possible that Mueller would indict the president for obstruction of justice. Recent reports, however, suggest that Democrats are not seeking to impeach Donald Trump. Yet it is noted that they are opposed to take the House, thus sending Trump's tyrant rules and bring back checks and balances to our government. The chances, however, are about equal that Trump will resign than they are for him to be impeached. So those are some of the opening thoughts for today's live show. Now, I want to get into this because of the Russia probes, the news that we're all seeing that perhaps at least a kernel of that is the truth. What we're seeing in the news today is absolutely outlandish, and you can't make this stuff up. I think that what people are looking for is hope. I think that what the American people are looking at is a disaster. What the American people are looking at and saying, how did we get here? Well, I think that we got here because there was not nearly enough registered voters that actually went to the polls this last presidential term. Now, we're over that. We're beyond that presidential election. Sadly enough, we are seeing a horrifying example of what America is not. Who we have in the White House today certainly is not representing America. He surely is not representing you or me. He is not keeping America as a standard for hope and a standard of freedom. But what he has done is divide the country. And I'm not talking about dividing the country based on political affiliation or religious affiliation. But he is dividing America in more ways than what you can shake a stick at. But yet our Congress, the Senate, have refused to do anything to stop it. So we can get angry. We can say it's time for us to get a little bit mad, to get a bit angry with what's going on. But that's the right now. And maybe we should. Maybe the American people do need to stand up and get a little angry. But in that anger, in that aggravation, maybe then we can say, you know what, anything is possible. It is possible that this this tyrant-like behavior, this mob boss mentality that we are seeing is only going to be for a short time. I don't think, honestly, that America can continue on this same path that has been laid out before us in the last year, and consider that a norm, or consider that as something that is acceptable. America is better than that, aren't we? America is better than what we are seeing today. So we see the disaster right now. Everybody now, everybody can literally see the handwriting on the wall. And you know what I've said from day one, folks, that the handwriting on the wall, it's up there. Very few are seeing it, but now more and more people are beginning to see it. Not nearly enough people are seeing it. But it really is an eye-opening experience to see people finally being able to understand and to see what's really going on. And then question, why isn't Congress and the U.S. Senate, why aren't they standing up to the plate? Why aren't they representing America? Why aren't they holding true to the cause and the allegiance of serving as a lawmaker? But a lot of these people are being bought out. They're being sold out the whole route. And guess what? There's nobody so far, nobody that has stood up to the plate to stop them from doing it. Thus, there has been no checks and balances of power. None in the last year and a half. So looking ahead a year and a half, we should look through our most inner being. We need to be in tune with this. For a year and a half into the future, what kind of an America are we going to live in a year and a half's time? We have already seen substantial damage, not just to our partners around the globe, other countries that are our allies. We have not just seen Trump coming down and against our allies and saying, you know what, we're going to pose tariffs on you. We're going to pose tariffs on the goods that you guys bring into America. America first. It's the way to do it. So we're going to impose all of these tariffs and making fun of lawmakers, not just in the United States, not just our FBI, our CIA, for crying out loud, who knows? Maybe even the Pentagon. Maybe he was making fun of people at the Pentagon and calling them names. Browbeating them maybe into submission. This is crazy. And you can't make it up. Folks, what we are seeing in the news these days is nothing shy but of a horror story from 1930s. Speaking of the tariffs, the last time that America imposed tariffs on the global market scene, it caused the Great Depression. The Great Depression was not just felt in America, but it was felt around the world. Every civilized country, industrialized nation suffered the consequence if they were partners with or allies with the United States or not. And now here we have a leader. And what he is doing is making friends, well, made a friend, with a dictator. Not just one, but two dictators. And trying to hold secret meetings with them. One of which was Putin. There was a two-hour window that nobody knows what happened. Nobody was there besides Trump and Putin and an interpreter. So nobody knows, not even our own lawmakers know, what was said and what wasn't. That was scary. It's still scary. Now, some folks think that the Mueller investigation should be over. It should be done with. That's the end of the story. It should be. I want to know, what do you think? Do you believe that the Mueller investigation should be over, or do you think that he should continue on unrestrained and to be able to move ahead with his findings? I find it even a little bit odd as of yesterday in the news. Did you all catch this? I'm probably sure you did. I mean, who could not miss this? But the Attorney General, Jeff Sessions, when he said, and when he refused to bow to political pressure from Donald Trump, saying that the Department of Justice is not going to get involved in this. The Department of Justice, they have their constitutional duty, and that's exactly what they're doing. You know, that's the first time that Jeff Sessions said something that I did agree with. So hooray to Jeff Sessions. I congratulate him. Look, folks, we are facing an absolute dilemma that can be stopped. I don't need to keep going over what the bad of it is. We all know this. But now we need to be posed as Americans, as voters, to take it to the poll. Here recently I posted a poll on Facebook, of all places, Facebook. And I asked our fans of the show, would you vote Democrat just in order to impeach Donald Trump? And 90% said yes, that they would vote Democrat if they were Democrat, or even if they were Republican, if they were military. And I've got several fans of the live show that are military members. But would you vote specifically to impeach Donald Trump? And 90% said yes. Folks, here is a big problem. A big problem. Although it may seem that impeachment of Donald Trump potentially could be the way or a better way to handle it, to finally get rid of the problem. Well, it's not going to get rid of the problem because the current seats and those who sit on them in Congress and in the U.S. Senate, they need to be looked at too. They need to be looked at in their history. They need to look, as the voters, we have the right to look back at their voting records, what have they stood for, and ask the ageless question, are they worthy of your vote? Now let's get the Democrat and let's get the Republican titles off the table for the time being, all right? We have to look at the people. We have to consider what are these people standing up for, or what are they sitting down against? Are they standing up to Donald Trump and stopping him? Are they in a position to declare that there is law and order? Three, are they going to stand up to Donald Trump and say, you know what? No, it's the Congress and it's the U.S. Senate that holds the checks and balances. And they would prohibit the office of the president from being such a disaster. Now, these are great questions. So why aren't they standing up to the plate and doing so? Of any time. And, you know, folks, I want to say this as abundantly clear as that I can. As slowly as I can, right? Because I want you to get the picture. I want you to capture this. And maybe for the first time say, you know what? Maybe I hadn't thought of that. This coming midterm election in November, it is going to be the most vital midterm election in American history. This is it. Now, you may not look at it that way, right? But your grandparents, your great-grandparents, perhaps your great-great-grandparents would have loved to be in the position that you are in right now. This is why. Because this midterm election upcoming in November, it is either going to stop a tyrant, it is going to put checks and balances back into our democracy, or by the nature of the votes, by the nature of the public going to the poll and voting or not, is going to determine if our democracy is going to live or if it is going to die. It's not serious. We are either going to allow what is going on presently to continue on and give it a wink, wink. We're tired of the way things are. We're tired of our democracy. And we like this new thing that's going on. We like this a whole lot better. So because of that, we're going to vote this way, or we're simply not going to vote because we don't care. You have then accepted defeat. You have then accepted what we're seeing today and calling it the norm, whereas there's nothing normal about it. It is the most abnormal pile of mess that I think that I've ever seen in my life, politically. So you, as the voter, you are in such a powerful position. The position of power that you have, it is so great that your grandparents never had. Your great-grandparents never had it. Your great-great-grandparents, going back in history, right? They didn't have it. Why? Because, simply put, they were not faced with the colossal dilemma, the horrifying nature of what we're seeing today. The dumbing down of America, it is well on its way. Or is it? Are we going to accept the dumbing down of America and say, you know what, this is the new norm. Everybody, you know, hey, what we're seeing today, this is the new deal, the new norm, and we like it better. It excites the base a little bit better. Folks, let's get rid of this. Let's stop this. Again, it's not a matter of, well, I'm going to vote for him because he's a Republican, or I'm going to vote for her because she's a Democrat, or I'm going to vote for him because he's a socialist Democrat. Democrat socialist. And people have a tendency to only look at, oh, Democrat, bad. Ooh, Republican, good. Check, check, check. They're going to check it all off right down the line and vote party line on. It doesn't matter what they stand for. As long as they're Democrat or Republican. Let's stop this. Folks, our freedom, our democracy, it is very much under attack. Now, the worst culprit in all of this are voters who do not vote. It is people who refuse to stand up and to be counted. It is people that by the nature of them refusing to vote and refusing to stand up, that they're saying, you know what, I'm going to accept what's going on. I'm going to accept what's happening now and call it the norm. I don't see any problems with what's going on. I think it's great. You know what? Our economy, yes, our economy is doing some better. The job market, the job situation, not faring so much. Wall Street, of course, Wall Street numbers are up and down like a roller coaster. Private investments, is that panning out? Maybe for some it is. Maybe for some it isn't. But the stability and the increase in our economy alone is not enough to keep voting for idiots who refuse to stand up and hold the checks and balances in place. It's simply not enough. If our economy, if we were doing that well, then you would expect that the military, and I'm not talking about the fighting machines, I'm talking about the VA healthcare, that they would not be in need of anything. I would be looking at Social Security and those that are on Social Security for them to get substantial raises, 2 to 3 times the amount that they live on presently. I'm looking at those that depend on food stamps just to live, put food on the table, that their benefit amounts would increase drastically, right? I'm looking at the cost of health care, that the cost of health care overall would go down because, after all, the economy is booming. You would think that the cost of gasoline would go down, crude oil, that the cost of it would go down because our economy is booming. But those are all fine and dandy to think about. But in reality, it was easier to give the billionaires, the upper 0.1% of our nation, to give them the multi-billion dollar tax breaks than it would have been for them to say, you know what, this is not the trickle-down economic system anymore. We can do better than that. Why don't we invest money where it needs to go? Why don't we invest in housing? Why don't we invest in the future of generations and their education? No more student loans. Get rid of the student loans. Forgive what's outstanding. And offer free tuition for higher education for those in America who would seek it. Now, that would be fair. But there isn't one politician that has ever said that. Not one politician has ever stood up and said, look, we are going to offer free education and we're going to roll back the taxes on the ultra rich, the millionaires, the billionaires of our society. We're going to roll back these tax cuts for them and for corporate America. And so everybody is going to be paying their fair share. But by the way, everybody is going to get free health care. You know what? I looked it up. It would cost $32 trillion to have free health care in the United States. $32 trillion. Now you say, oh, that's just going to add to the national debt. No, it's not. No, it's. I should have been a politician. But it's not going to add to the national debt. Not hardly. But folks, what is or what would offset that would be finally to put limits on the cost of health care. It would be great even to put limits on tax deductions for the rich and for the large businesses in America. So rather than giving them one company $30 billion to invent one screw that goes on an airplane, right, in America, proudly made in America, that one single part. Think of it. So $32 trillion then is nothing. And the $32 trillion then that it would cost when you take away all of these other free subsidies or these other free giveaways just because you happen to be wealthy. It kind of puts it into perspective. So, but why aren't our lawmakers talking on those terms? Why aren't our lawmakers standing up and saying, you know what, this tyrant-like behavior, it is not acceptable. So this puts you, ladies and gentlemen, it puts you in that power seat that your grandparents didn't see. They couldn't, it wasn't time. Your great-grandparents or your great-great-grandparents could not vote in an election, midterm election, like you're going to, I hope, this November. Isn't that staggering? Isn't that a bit staggering? So we have a choice to either accept what's going on and call it a day, or you have the opportunity to say, you know what, this is just politics. It's just the norm. I don't know what everybody's so angry about. You're not seeing the handwriting on the wall. Because what's happening to our country can be prevented. What is happening to America, to Americans, to our families, to the breadbasket of America, to Wall Street, to the working poor, something can be changed. And surely, having said that, surely, it's up to you to change it. We'll be right back. I'm Robert Christian.